Okay, great. Will you bring up the slides? Okay, wonderful. Well, gosh, it's so nice to see everyone joining from so many different points across the U.S. That's really exciting. I'm very pleased to introduce this particular data sharing and reuse seminar, which is being held on behalf of the Office of Data Science Strategy at NIH. This office started in 2018 and has the goal of modernizing and integrating a fair biomedical data ecosystem. We have 5 themes to reach this goal, and the FAIR principles are a fundamental part of how we think about achieving this goal of a modern data ecosystem. Next slide, please. We started this seminar series in February, so we're relatively new and very excited to have so many speakers join us. This is an opportunity for researchers to share their success stories around data sharing and reuse, and also to highlight the wonderful programs at across the 27 institutes and centers that make up NIH. We've had some really wonderful nominations of speakers from each of those centers, and so we see this as a really wonderful way to highlight data sharing and reuse across the NIH mission space. And I'll be in just a minute, I'll be introducing Chris Kissinger to talk briefly about the upcoming speaker. But before I do that, let me just highlight a couple of news items. Next slide, please. Yeah, that's great. So we have a couple of notices of special interest open to the public right now for submitting proposals. Proposals are due relatively soon, but there are some particularly exciting areas. This one is about better enabling data discoverability, interoperability, and reuse. So really helping our repositories address the FAIR principles and trust principles, as well as the government-wide desirable characteristics for research repositories. Next slide, please. We have another opportunity for supplemental funding, and this is in the area of software enhancement. Excuse me. So thinking about how researchers can help make their software better engineered and also, in particular, more cloud-ready. Next slide, please. Before we move on to our speaker for today, I just wanted to highlight that we will have our next seminar on June 11th at noon Eastern Time. And our speaker will be Laura Mangravit. And she will be talking to us about a particular project related to Alzheimer's disease and the Data Coordinating Center for that. You can see more about our future seminars and past recordings at this link. And so right now I'd like to introduce Chris Kissinger, who is the Common Fund Data Ecosystem Data Coordinating Center Engagement Director. He joined the Office of Strategic Coordination in 2020, and he helps integrate data from multiple Common Fund programs with the Common Fund Data Ecosystem. He came to that role from being a program director for the Clinical Proteomic Tumor Analysis Consortium at the National Cancer Institute. And when he was there, he led operations for data management and biospecimen processing. So he's a wonderful person to introduce our next speaker. So let me hand it over to you, Chris. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Laura. So in this brief time, I'm going to give a little overview of the Common Fund data ecosystem, which I would say is a small part of the larger NIH data ecosystem that Laura alluded to. But first, what is the Common Fund? Well, the Common Fund is a set of research programs that really transcend NIH institutes and centers. And for that reason, they're run out of the Office of the Director. Right now, we have 26 programs. These tend to have a 10-year time limit so that they don't just continue on indefinitely. And they all have to have these 5 characteristics. They have to be transformative, catalytic, synergistic, cross-cutting, and unique. So some of the, you may have heard of some of the more popular programs like GTEx or the Gabriella Miller Kids First, which we'll hear about today some. So these are Common Fund programs. And our leadership, as they're thinking about our Common Fund programs, they've been running for over 10 years. They recognize some challenges regarding the high value data sets generated by these programs. So first, How would a scientist combine data sets from multiple Common Fund programs? Since each program tends to have a standalone data coordinating center, integrating data sets across programs turns out to be non-trivial. Secondly, what happens to the data after the program's funding cycle ends? And thirdly, with more and more research data moving to cloud environments, what do we need to do to train scientists to work with Common Fund data in the cloud? So these three questions really motivated the launch of what we're calling the Common Fund Data Ecosystem, or CFDE. So it started in 2019, and the CFDE currently has a coordinating center, 9 Common Fund program data coordinating centers engaged in building the CFDE. The funded DCCs include these nine programs here. So as I mentioned, we'll hear some today about Kids First and maybe some GTECs and some of these others. But really from xRNA down to the human microbiome program, they're all actively engaged. There are 4 or 5 other programs that we're talking about also engaging with the Common Fund data ecosystem, and there'll probably be future Common Fund programs that will engage with the CFDE. In addition, the Common Fund is supporting 12 small research awards, RO3s, to enhance the utility and use of Common Fund data sets. These RO3 awards will also help inform and refine what CFDE is doing. And today, we will hear about one of these awardees' research in integrating Common Fund data sets for feature selection and machine learning. Okay, and then the Common Fund data ecosystem aims to provide the infrastructure needed to create a functioning ecosystem that makes Common Fund data sets more impactful by enabling easier data access and use. So we have 3 key goals, and they correspond to those 3 questions I mentioned earlier. First, to query across and use Common Fund data sets. Secondly, to sustain Common Fund data and tools. And third, to train users to work with Common Fund data, especially in cloud environments. CFDE is working to bridge between data producers and data users and includes efforts to create a CFDE portal that will allow researchers to access and work across multiple Common Fund data program data sets with a digital cloud environment, enabling and creating cloud workspaces and application programming interfaces, APIs, as well as connecting to data in other NIH programs. So this is our overall vision for CFDE. And my last overview slide asks the question, what will CFDE do for scientists? Well, we expect in the coming years, CFDE will improve the ability to discover data through an integrative search portal. We're working with the researcher auth service known as RAS and the NIH Cloud Platform Interoperability Working Group to facilitate data access between the CFDE search portal and cloud platforms. In addition to harmonizing metadata, some CFDE projects are harmonizing data sets of a common data type by processing them through a common pipeline to ease reuse. So we're really focused on making data more fair. Additionally, working toward interoperability at the platform level, training researchers to conduct data science in the cloud, and maintaining availability of Common Fund data sets beyond their lifetime are also CFDE activities that we believe will benefit scientists for years to come. So that's a small overview of the CFDE. It's now my privilege to introduce this afternoon's speaker, Dr. Deanne Taylor, who is the Director of Bioinformatics at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia Research Institute. Dr. Taylor obtained degrees in physics and biophysics before taking up bioinformatics at a postdoc with Pfizer. Her scientific contributions have encompassed workflows for clinical genetic disorders, bioinformatics methods development, analysis of early embryo development in single cells, and protein function and structure analysis. For the Common Fund, she is the principal investigator for the Data Coordinating Center of the Gabriella Miller Kids First Data Resource Center and the PI of a pilot project enhancing utility and usage of Common Fund data sets, which will be the topic of her talk today. Deanne, the floor is yours.
Now, thanks, Chris. That was a wonderful introduction to the CFTE, and I now don't feel like I have to go too much into that. I'm assuming you can see my slides now.
Yes, they look great.
Good? Okay, great. So, as Chris mentioned, my background, even though I'm a bioinformatician, I'm also a biologist. I kind of walk the line almost exactly between solid, you know, traditional computer science and biology, because in biophysics, I had to do both. Back in the days when you had to develop your own kernels for your own machines and that kind of thing. I'm kind of an older bioinformatician. So back then you had to write everything. There was, dbSNP was still young, and there weren't, you know, bioconductor was still starting to take off. So back in the days you had to do a lot of that. So we were forced to be both. So I tend to think of data in that kind of way, and as a basic kind of, as almost a currency for learning. And so this kind of project came about because myself and Ryan Abanowitz, where we collaborate on some other projects, started talking about some of the challenges in discovering variation and the causative variation in diseases, especially in kids first. So I just want to have a disclaimer. I like to put this up that I'm a PI in the Kids First Data Resource Center grant, but I don't speak for Kids First, and of course not for the Common Fund either. So when I mention these things, I'm speaking as a user of these or PI of the grant itself, but not of the program. So I want to put up my thank you slide first, because just in case I don't get to it at the end in time, the people doing the work right now are Ben Steer on the left there. Ben is somebody who's been working from the beginning of the project on integrating a lot of the Common Fund data into a graph utilizing the UMLS, which I'll talk about in a bit, and Taha Massini, who has just recently joined my group, but he's also working right now on the Lynx data, integrating a small molecule protabogens and other data from harmonosome into the knowledge graph. We're also collaborating with HubMap because of the CFDE, and I became involved with the CFDE through Kids First. It became a very rich environment, and all of a sudden there were a lot of people interested in what we were doing, which is really, you know, complementary. A lot of this work is complementary to what we're doing. So there's been a lot of back and forth, a lot of some of the Common Fund projects involved. Jonathan Silverstein, especially at HubMap and his group, which I'll discuss what they've been able to do with the UMLS and also other ontologies they've been helping with us, and of course the Kids First DRC. And on the right-hand side are all the different players that have been advising us along the way, including CFDE, Owen White, and Kristen Ardley and the GTEx team. We also had help from Tiffany Callahan, who wrote Phenolator. If you want to look that up on GitHub, it's a really useful tool. Also Monarch and Nico Matenzoglu, who's been working with us on the crosswalk, which is a difficult project between the mouse phenotype and the human phenotype ontologies. And of course, the rest of the Monarch team and also Lawrence Livermore, at LBL, it's Justin Reese and Chris Mungall who've been advising us on ontologies. So Kids First data resource cohorts. Kids First is a very large Common Fund effort, and if you're not aware of it, it's really focused on genotyping, not just genotyping, but whole genome sequencing children with structural birth defects and childhood cancers and their families, usually in trios, sometimes and in some cases some extended families with certain syndromes, but for the most case it's 16,000, roughly 16,000 cases with the 40,000 genomes of family members. And in some cases, we may not have family members, but for the majority, we do. So on the left-hand side are all the ones that have been released. Everything in italics are cancer data sets. And you can see it's a very large amount of phenotypes. And each of these phenotypes, children within each of these cohorts could have multiple phenotypes as well. There's very often a child with a birth defect could have other kinds of comorbidities or other kind of birth defects or other kinds of conditions that are affecting them. And so there's really a lot of heterogeneity in this, even what appears to be a large data set, there's even more data sets, there tends to be even more heterogeneity than I'm representing here. So trying to find genetic causes in all of these is what most of the people who are studying these cohorts are trying to do. Are there common genetic causes within or between any of these syndromes? And it turns out that there's actually a connection between birth defects and childhood cancer. As an aside, even though 3% of US newborns are diagnosed with some kind of structural birth defect, ranging from mild to very severe, there's also a link between a higher risk of pediatric cancer, childhood cancer, in children that are born with structural birth defects, sometimes at the same location where the birth defect occurred. So we know it's probably a disease of development. There's probably some sort of genetic cause or genetic, either somatic or germline, born in the genome kind of effect that's happening. Either they inherited it or it's something that appeared in their generation as they, in their germline, particular to them, that would be like a de novo mutation. But when people study these, there's only about 20 to 60%, depending on the cohort and the luck, of actually determining a causative variant or a causative genetic effect that's leading to that birth defect or childhood cancer. And that's unfortunately the truth of the matter. The data is very large. We don't know a lot about what genes do, especially during development. That's still an ongoing area of study, trying to understand how dynamic changes happen during development. These kind of dynamic changes represent windows of susceptibility where organs develop, and where those organs and how those organs are utilizing those gene programs. If there's genetic variations in groups of genes, they may work together to cause a phenotype that may appear as a birth defect at the end of gestation. So there's technical challenges as well, trying to determine what could be causing these variations, there might be technical problems in trying to determine what variation may lead to a disease. And those could be just like power in trying to understand what you're looking at. Like there might not be enough coverage in the genome there, or maybe a variant that's part of a copy numbered event, or other kinds of things that could prevent you from detecting that. But there's also things like that could be complex combinations of variants. And one of the things we're interested in is epistasis. Between myself and Ryan, are there multiple combinations or interactions between genes that when they have a variation lead to a phenotype of a birth defect? And there, of course, there's this problem, as I mentioned earlier, the annotation is not great. There's a lot of genes that don't have annotations that that allow us to go in and determine whether or not that gene might be responsible with a variation towards the birth defect or even a developmental phenotype. And then there's, of course, any kind of mathematical statistical methods for discovery aren't always optimized for looking at multiple genes or even in large collections of variants. So in the Kids First database, there's a new feature called the variant workbench. And the variant discovery is often used. This is the way a typical investigator would think about variant discovery. When they go in, they do their sequencing, they want to look at their cohort or group of cohorts. You can see the numbers are quite large. So this is the variant workbench at the time released on January 21st this year. It had 5,000 participants entered into the variant warehouse. That's 26 billion occurrences of individual variants that are different than the reference sequence. So that's about 5 million variant occurrences per individual. You do the math. And if you just take the unique variants, it's about 215 million. But let's talk about one individual person, about 5 million variants. A typical investigator might spend many hours looking for keys or causative variants under the streetlight that's represented by, well-annotated genes. But suppose a researcher knows that they want to look at the winter frizzle pathway because that's important in development and maintenance or dynamics and signaling. So they may be interested in wind, and they pick LGR6, which is a G protein coupled receptor. Transmembrane receptor, and they might be interested in that. So if they just do a search on these 5,000 participants just for LGR6, they come across already 7,700 different variants. The first three there, these first three are probably severe in that they interrupt the gene somehow. They're frameshift variants or stop gain. The variant interrupts the coding sequence of the gene. But after that, all these missense variants, of which there are many, are in a way undetermined until you go into the lab and try to see if this makes it or predict whether or not this makes a significant change to the protein structure. Often they're a lower rank because usually clinicians prioritize these kind of high priority variants in their work. But it turns out that if you look at this one particular variant that doesn't have a dbSNP ID, because this might be a novel variant, it's not registered in dbSNP, so it hasn't been seen before, at least not been registered before. it turns out to be one person with this variant. And then you could look at the effect of it and the deleterious score and what transcript or isoform it comes from, what form of the gene it comes from. You get more information about this. But it turns out, I just randomly picked LGR6. There are possibly thousands of variants per person that could be, you know, deleterious, or at least hundreds of variants that could be deleterious at that, and thousands that could be potentially deleterious because of a missense mutation. So the job of the investigators is always trying to dig all this out per person or per cohort. But, you know, our idea was like, is there a way that we can use the Common Fund datasets to reduce this feature space, to reduce all those millions or thousands of variants per individual, while simultaneously being able to use that curated data set to go and do more complex analyses down the line? So this has been done before. This is not a new idea. This has been done, I mean, this is a review from Jason Moore, who's one of the people that I know at Penn, but this is just an example of what he did in 2008 as a review article. So people are already thinking about reducing feature space using biological evidence for a long time. Our difference is that we're just gonna be looking at Common Fund data. So we were interested in driving the discovery of genetic causes of birth defects in childhood cancer, by leveraging the information-rich data sets of machine learning methods and using Common Fund data for that, but essentially taking the idea that birth defect phenotypes can arise from these complex interactions between genes that are either inherited or de novo, you know, appearing in that person before birth. And we can call this epistasis as an interaction between variants or between genes as features to yield a phenotype. And I'll be using that word features a lot to basically mean features on the genome. But, you know, there tests for multivariate associations, if you're trying to do the gene to gene or multiple variant associations, are prohibited. Even if you do a one by one comparison, like between pairs of variants or pairs of genes, let's say the variants, if we want to do 5 million variants, that's a 5 million by 5 million, which is about 12 trillion calculations, which is actually doable for modern computers and not too much of a long time, but that's only one out of several thousands of people. So it starts to be prohibitive just in a one by one comparison. But then when you start thinking about, you know, 3 and 4 and 5, it starts to become astronomical. And that is really difficult for computers to handle. So one of the ways that people can do this is break this down by saying, all right, let's take all the pairs of things, but let's break it out only into genes. So then you're only dealing between 14,000 and 20,000 or more features, you know, in the tens of thousands level of features. And that really brings you down several orders of magnitude, but then you're also trying to guess at the effects of those variants and specifics. And that sometimes can penalize what kind of discoveries you can make. But we can also use information-rich data sets to do the keys under the streetlight again, but try to expand it out a little bit more than just rather look to see the things that have direct annotation, the things that may have indirect relationships, and create gene lists that are much smaller than the tens of thousands that we have. Or variants that are associated with those genes from the tens of thousands that we have, and bring it down to a number that, you know, these kind of complex calculations are going to be easier and more tractable for computers. So this is the award that we got from, this is that RFA that Chris mentioned, the pilot projects enhancing utility and uses of Common Fund data sets. And our idea, of course, was to identify this gene to gene and variant to variant interactions, because that's something that Ryan is very keen on. And I'm very keen on machine learning as well, and also in data integration that seemed to work out as a great partnership. But it did require data organization and mechanisms of data selection in order to meaningfully integrate data from humans and model organisms. And model organisms are important, and COMP2 was a Common Fund data set. It's been also kind of subsumed into a much larger mouse phenotype consortium called the IMPC. So we brought in IMPC, but it's essentially using COMP2 data. And what that is model organism data is easy to manipulate, or easier to manipulate than human embryos, right? So, you know, we can understand development and developmental processes early on by knockout phenotypes in the mouse. So we brought in the mouse data, which is important for us to understanding birth defects and development. Also GTEx, which I'll talk about in a bit, and links are both also data rich for what we set out to do. And we decided to form a knowledge graph, and I'll explain why in a bit. Supported by a graph database. And then we wanted to provide these methods for prioritization of genomic features, as I just mentioned. And aim two would be using the machine learning approach towards detection of the multi-gene or multivariant interactions. So I just want to show a little bit of what Ryan's work. He's built a kind of a pipeline to use multiple machine learning approaches to understanding, to modeling gene-to-gene interactions And he's been able to, this is kind of like a, just a graphic of what his lab does. We would start here, the data set, the features that were to be selected from the Common Fund database that we're building. And then he would go through a series of genetic testing and filtering, and then cross-validation, partitioning, permutation testing, and modeling, et cetera. And then at the end of it, he would have basically a p-value or a significance value of a pathway or a group of genes related to the set of variants that we have from, say, kids first. And it would say something about that relationship between that pathway or sets of genes and that cohort. So we did this for a cohort of cardiovascular defect cohorts, it was heart defect cohort. And we actually, when we just did univariate, we're using something called the gene set enrichment analysis, but I'm not going to go into that right now. Maybe in a future date, Ryan can present on this somewhere. But the GC approach that they're using, just using univariate typical types of tests on the genetics, didn't yield very much in ways of p-values. So we didn't really end up with a very strong signal on anything that looked like against this cohort of their variants and genes. But when we use this more machine learning approach of looking at epistasis in the smaller set, we actually ended up with several cardiac gene signals or cardiac GO ontology signals that came out. So when you use this GO ontology pathway and you look for epistatic interactions between the genes in that pathway, it actually came up with a pretty strong signal on permutation. So that gave us an idea before we put in this application that there is a signal there, an epistasis, if you can correctly start using these kinds of pathways for that kind of analysis. But we realized that GO is one way of looking at things, but GO is only annotating the things that are known or things that have evidence. But what if we want to try to expand out and use pathways or relationships that aren't really covered by some of these pathways? And that's where we came up with this idea. So Common Fund data sets that we proposed for feature selection started with kids first, and then using the knowledge, assembling the knowledge graph on these three data sets. GTEx provides tissue, EQTL loci, and transcription data. So tissue to expression, right? Genes, tissues, and expression are all in the GTEx. And then even though it's adult tissue, from the previous results, those GO categories are really adult categories, but these were children with birth defects. So there's clearly cardiac signal in more what we consider adult processes that are showing up in kids with cardiovascular defects and their collections of variants. So there's always this idea of central regulators or master regulators for gene expression in different tissues. That could be a cause. So we weren't put off by including GTEx for that reason. Lynx has data on protabogens, and also harmonosome with Avi Mayan has worked on, puts together a whole bunch of data supporting different types of pathways and other types of integrated data. So we plan on integrating that into our knowledge graph. And of course, COMP2, which is the phenotype versus gene manipulations in mice. So we have phenotypes and we have genes in mice that we can link to the data. So can we put all this together to do feature selection? There's also other Common Fund data sets, and I didn't list them all. There's actually 17 out of the, 35 or so Common Fund data sets have high throughput data of some form. So we could, in theory, probably look at many, many different data sets in the Common Fund to do this. The first one that we're thinking about doing is HubMap, and then things with IDG, UDN, all of these have potential to be added into this knowledge graph in the future. So what's a graph database? Can we actually implement feature selection? So we decided to use a graph database because it allows for these native data relationships, the relationship between gene or cell line or gene and pathway or gene and phenotype. And this is just a toy model that I included here for what a graph database would look like. The pros are that it's easy to ingest and assemble complex data relationships, because here we know that in this cell line, this gene could be deleted in, amplified in, overexpressed in, or mutated in the cell line. And you could have a gene of a specific ID, a cell in a specific ID, and create one of these relationships would link them together or multiple. And then you could describe how that gene relates to the cell line through that connection, through that edge or that link. And then the cons are for graph databases, this looks really great and you can ingest the data by natural, what we consider quote natural relationships, but you have to be very careful with the design and the usage of it and how you query it, because your query and your usage may be very sensitive to how that data is structured when you've loaded it in. So you have to be very careful in how you think about the utility of this graph. You have to evaluate it. You have to load your data and evaluate it. make sure that the queries you have are believable. So it's a little bit more work than a different type of work than typical SQL type of databases. So so our idea was here in a graphic is we start with a bunch of databases, including ontology data, which I'll go into a minute. We aggregate the data in all these different forms. We have the genes, the tissues, the agents, and the phenotypes. And then this is an actual snapshot, a little tiny mini snapshot. It's only 30K at about 8 million nodes in our data, but it gives you an idea. It's a big hairball, right? And for those of us who know hairballs, we're like, it's just another hairball, which it is. But the idea is that we're going to start with a question. With the data points from kids first, it could be a gene and or a variant and or a tissue and or a phenotype and or an agent. Any of those items we could come in with and it could be coming out of kids first. It could be chemotherapies. It could be genes. It could be variants. It could be the tissue of affected tissue. It could be phenotypes. It doesn't even just have to be kids first data. It could be any data point, but let's start with kids first data. Can I find all selectable common fund data in any of those categories that relate to the thing that I'm putting in? So if you imagine the center of this yellow circle is your data point that you want to start off with, you can then query outwards from there. You can say, find me all the data sets that have this gene within them, and find me all the phenotypes associated with that or all the data points associated with that gene. And it could be many different things if it's high throughput data. And then you could, and you know, design your query that you go to a second level where you go and say, then, you know, if I start with a gene, give me all the phenotypes in mouse, and then from mouse phenotypes, give me all the mouse genes, and then give me all the pathways associated with those mouse genes, and then bring me back to more human genes from those pathways. So you could go out in different directions depending on your query. And then at the result, you'll end up with a group of variables or features that you can then use in more complex analyses. So we had additional objectives to the RO3, which is to provide programmatic templates or APIs for the use of this data. So it's not going to be simply just, oh, we've invented this database, but can we make it usable for people? So it would be mostly usable by people with bioinformatics experience, but we're also going to be creating tutorials for people using it for the first time, and it shouldn't hopefully not be too difficult for people to use. Because graph database queries are not usually very difficult to write, especially if we provide people with templates. So we're going to be allowing, this will hopefully allow researchers to perform deeper and more custom feature guided applications. We're also going to be refining methods on feature selection on the AIM-2 after we do the knowledge graph, where we're going to be doing univariate, polygenic, and epistatic interaction analyses with machine learning and typical statistical methods. So that'll be kind of later after the feature selection. And then, of course, everything related to the knowledge graph will be openly available on GitHub, and it won't expose protected data. All of this data is freely available in public. So let me talk a little bit about design now that I've given you all that introduction, which was important for me to give, because you can kind of see where we're coming from. The knowledge graph design, our AIM-1 in our RO3 was to just break it out. This isn't exactly what was written there, but this is our concept. We have to create musculus ontological concepts in a graph, right? Mammalian phenotype and gene ID. So we need to support comp2. We need ways of representing phenotypes in mice and genes in mice. We need to create links between orthology services. So we need to link mouse to human, right? So now we have the mouse data. We know that when you knock out this gene in mouse, it leads to cardiac birth defect. So we need to have the phenotype of cardiac birth defect in mouse linked to cardiac birth defect in human. That's the mouse, that would be the musculus to HPO, or the, I'm sorry, the mammalian phenotype to HPO, which Nico is working on. And then we have the homology, of course, between human and mouse genes. We need an accurate homology mapping between the two. So now if we introduce mouse and human data, it has to be mapped between them. And then we also have to ingest the comp2 phenotype genotype data into the data, for example, into the knowledge graph. And we also want to ingest genotype tissue expression, genotype to tissue expression data as expression values, and also as EQTLs, which show the relationship between a variant and its effect on expression of a gene somewhere else in the genome, usually often on the same chromosome. But you know, these EQTLs are kind of measured with p-values, the kind of a measurement of association between one variant and its effect on gene expression. So we have to put that into the database as well. We'd like to add the links or enriched related data sets to include pathways, phenotypes, genes, and perturbogens, which I didn't mention here. And also, if we could stretch a little bit further, we'd like to start adding HubMap data in here. Since HubMap, when we first wrote this RO3, HubMap had not yet released their data, but after we did it, their data is now released, and we're actually working with HubMap, as I mentioned earlier. So we had a CFDE meeting, and I was talking to Jonathan Silverstein, who's I believe is the technical director at HubMap, and in 2020, and he mentioned that he presented that he's created a Neo4 graph database on the UMLS, which is the Unified Medical Language System. And unless you're a clinical data geek, you probably have never used it. And if you are, then you know UMLS pretty well. And it's there's a link for it up there. It's actually pretty interesting. It's kind of like an Uber ontology. It has 200 ontologies and vocabularies all integrated together on something they call concepts. It's originally geared to like managing SNOMED and ICD-10 values, but recently after its inception, they started including genes and things like OMIM, right? So we have OMIM, we have SNOMED, mesh terms, gene ontology now, anatomy, NCBI taxonomy, and other subdomains, and there's a lot of information that's linked. So this is, if you look at this, this looks like a graph database, right? This is, here you have relationships between different things. You have amino acids, tumor suppressor proteins, here's the gene itself, and how it relates to diseases, and how it could relate to Drosophila and GenBank, et cetera. So this is kind of like, we were saying, well, wait a minute, this is great. He's gone and taken the UMLS schema and turn it into a graph database. And we were starting up the RO3, and we realized that this is the ontology system that we could use because they do integrate HPO. They do have HPO in there. They have NCIT for cancer terms and general phenotype terms. So, and the gene ontology. So all of these are built in now. And so if we already have the UMLS, why don't we just start trying to put our data, our mouse data in there, and our other data in there in such a way that we can use this as the knowledge graph. So this is kind of like a really like top level snapshot of what the knowledge graph looks like. This is only a little query that's looking at a transdermal patch, but the idea is that you have these concept codes. Here's two different concept codes. The concept code is kind of like the central pivot for most of the things in UMLS. It really is just literally a number. It represents a thing. It could be a gene, it could be a phenotype, it could be an OMIM entry. It's kind of like a thing. And then they have attached to them these things called codes, which describe the codes like, for example, HPO is a code, or RX norm is a code. It is a concept, could have multiple codes. So you could have a concept of phenotype, and you could have NCIT and HPO both on codes facing onto that concept. That concept is a number, but you could have codes from multiple different systems coming in the number saying, we all represent the same thing. We're all linked together on this concept. So this is one of the codes on this concept. And then there are terms associated with those. And those terms are usually telling you the exact information about that code related to that concept. So these are kind of like the details. And so this is kind of like the knowledge graph that's set up. And you can see here we have different types of relationships. They have ingredient of, has ingredient. And there's a lot of different relationships that are already built in UMLS and already coded. UMLS has them all built in. You're getting it all for free, which is really wonderful. So Jonathan also integrated on top of this. He also integrated Uberon onto UMLS, and also the cell ontology onto the UMLS, because he was interested in using these for HubMap. But this, our problem is UMLS is a human concept set, right? So it doesn't really have any room for mice, because they haven't really built animal models into there per se. UMLS is mostly focused on human data. So we wanted to include mouse ontologies and the mammalian phenotype ontology to support mouse and model organism data, at least mammalian model organism data. So as a bigger picture, I love to use this slide, and this came from Melissa Handel's group, and I adapted it. This is pretty, everything in the yellow checkbox has been done already, either by us or by Jonathan or by UMLS. For example, HPO is already in UMLS, the gene ontologies are in UMLS, and NCIT is already in UMLS. That comes for free. Jonathan added Uberon, we've added the mouse phenotype ontology, And to do, we'd like to also include Mondo and UMLS, and that's something that we're going to be working on this summer. But you can see there's all different types of data that we can also integrate. Now, data is different than ontology, right? So data is not an ontology. It's an ontology is a way of knowing something. It's a classification system. We're suggesting adding data into a classification system by creating the, making the data into a classifier, into a knowledge point. So this is one of our challenges for using UMLS. And we also created a link between the mouse phenotypes and the HPO. This is one of the activities I'll talk about in a minute. So this little mini hairball for you is kind of like a 30,000 snap, 30,000 foot view of what we've accomplished so far. I'm not going to go into details, but I just want to say that we have these concept codes are in these blue, larger blue ones. And I apologize if there's anyone's colorblind, but I tried to draw black lines around the ones that are terms. And the ones with the blue lines around them the blue lines around them are the codes. So for example, there's an ensemble code. I didn't draw the term on here, but there's a term associated with the ensemble code that would be out here that would be ENSG something. An HPO code would have a term that I didn't draw here that has some HPO something. Here's an example of entree gene code, which would have a term that would have a number that I neglected to put here. But you get the idea, every code has got a term. What we were able to do for the data points is bin the data points as knowledge. So instead of having a quantitative number like this is the p-value or this is the TPM or the transcripts per million for expression data, like when we have GTEx linked to the human gene concept, would link out to median expression and GTEx and also tissue. What we would have is a bin for TPN. So people could say, I only want those genes that have a TPM of greater than this or different than this bin. So it's not quantitative, but allows you to select quantitative bins. And that's how we dealt with the concepts in this in building this into UMLS. So here's an example of the first thing we did was we needed to create new concepts for mouse genes, mammalian phenotype, and we had to link those to genes and human phenotype. So that was pretty simple. The hardest part in all of this is trying to link the mouse phenotype to the human phenotype. This is an ongoing project with Nico and groups scattered around the United States and Europe, but we're trying to come up with a good way to describe birth defects using the mammalian phenotype and the human phenotype ontology. And that's work that's underway, but it's in the database now, but it needs to be continually refined. So we had to add new mouse gene concepts. So this is a concept for mouse gene and it has a code and it will have a term SSH, for example. And these gene concepts link to mammalian phenotype concepts through COMP2. So COMP2 would say that this is a phenotype, this gene knockout, or this gene has a phenotype of this, and that's directly from COMP2. So that data is now in the database. Also, this, as I mentioned, this is cross between mouse phenotype and human phenotype. There's also, I don't have it here, but there's also has gene comes back this way. I just didn't map it here, but this one that's has gene that goes back. So you have a phenotype that has a gene associated with it. And also the code for this would be the mammalian phenotype, and here's the terms that are related to those. So you can see how this is set up. Mouse gene to human gene was the same kind of idea. We're using the Hugo Gene Ontologies Orthology Service to generate a gene-to-gene ortholog relationship between human genes and mouse genes. We're not showing both directions here, but they do exist, and both directions in the phenotype. So you can actually have a human gene concept with all these additional IDs. We don't have all those IDs necessarily on the mouse genome yet, but we haven't done that yet, put additional terms on here that would expand it out, because there are alternative names for SHH and sonic hedgehog and mouse, but we just don't have those in place yet. And for the median TPM, this was the interesting part. We binned them. Here you can see there's a bin between 9 and 10. And that is represented as a searchable bin. So people can search for TPM bins when they search for their expression concept in the GTEx median expression concept. So here would be an expression concept code, and it would go to the term called TPM that would have that range. And that means that you could go between phenotype all the way over to expression concept through the links between all of these concepts. So again, ignore the directions because we only showed one directional ones here, but they go back and forth. So you should be able to say, pick a, you could in theory pick a GTEx TPM and go back to see how many phenotypes are related to that TPM through the human gene concept to the mouse, to a mouse mammalian phenotype concept, or vice versa. There are links between the human gene concepts and phenotypes, which I'm not showing here, but there's links between all of these that are relevant. So you should be able to go in any directions with your queries to go between them. So I want to show you a little bit of statistics, and it's good, I'm actually good on time, but statistics, we've added quite a few nodes to the actual existing UMLS knowledge graph in terms of 10 millions are on the left-hand side. So we've increased the number of nodes by adding GTEx data by about 44% in the concept codes, and that's right, in the concepts and the codes themselves and the terms have increased significantly. The terms probably, like I said, when we added the mouse, we didn't add a huge amount of terms. We need to increase our terms so that we have more flexibility in naming conventions. The new concepts that were added to the UMLS design or new HGNC for mouse musculus, we have the mouse phenotype ontology, a lot of DB SNP IDs, and those are coming out mostly from the GTEx EQTL. And then the EQTL data point concepts, and then the expression concepts, about 2 million. So those are all added to the design, as I showed you earlier. So we have quite a lot of data in that are there and queryable from GTEx. So this is the concept space, just the concepts, not the codes and not the terms, but this is the degree distribution of the connections between the concepts. And, you know, I usually just do this to look to see, I'm interested in, is this a small world network? Is this a Gaussian kind of distribution of degree distribution? I'm not going to talk about that today, maybe at a future date, but it really says something about the structure and the expected behavior of the hops between one side of the network and the other. And there's this little blip that we were curious about. That's an awful lot of degrees. Degrees measures how many connections are on a node. So this is saying underneath the question marks that there are some blip there where we have some concept codes that have 55,000 connections. So medical concepts may have many, many other connections to other medical concepts. And this is an example of one. This concept code had 55,000 other blue concept codes connected to it. And here's an example of one of them. And it turns out that they're connected by these things called allowed qualifiers and or can be qualified by. So that means that if you're trying to go from one side of the network to another and you happen to quickly hit on this node, you can go in 55,000 different directions, which is not exactly a great thing if you're trying to really rein in your query, right? So we have to do some probably either some pruning, which I would rather not do, or at least query conditioning to make sure that in these types of cases, we don't pull in these very, very connected nodes, because those hubs or so can actually reduce the hops between one side of the network and the other. In some cases, that's a good thing, but a lot of cases that's bad if you're trying, like I say, rein in the amount of results you get from your query. So we also looked at the degree distribution, and some of these degree distributions, it's really a measurement now on the human, we're only looking at the Hugo gene degree distribution in the orthologs. So we were interested to see what that looked like, and it didn't look terrible, but you know, one of the things that always amuses me, I always look at the highest one, and it's always TP53. Because if you do biology, you know that TP53 is involved in a lot of biologic processes, have been studied a lot. And there are a lot of phenotypes and relationships between phenotypes and the connections in that. So it turns out that their TP53 was one of the ones that had one of the highest number of degree connections on it between concept nodes and through code. So we have to go in again. If we can get around that by weighting connections, there have been other applications that if you weight those links between the two by degree distribution to reduce the basically you're making it more penalized to go through that node, you can somehow balance that off for a p-value if you're looking, or for a transversal if you're looking through the graph. So kind of penalize the ones that have a lot of connections to other genes or concepts to allow you to do more local searches instead of going through a very connected node to another part of the graph that may have nothing to do with what you're interested in. There's also other kinds of inherent graph considerations for this concepts. There's this there are many gene-to-gene relationships that come with UMLS, and they're not really well defined. I guess if we go and do more digging into the UMLS data, we might find why these were selected the way they were. We haven't done that yet. But these gene relationships like RO are, you know, kind of like a related kind of concept. So here's two genes that are connected. If you look at them, they're both dead box or DEH box helicases. But a researcher might say, why are these connected? Like, why are you connecting these two genes? Someone connected them somehow, but we didn't. Like in our analysis, we did not connect them. They came with UMLS. So we may need to provide like a condition kind of query so that these kinds of relationships are left out because those came with UMLS, but may not be responsive to what the investigator is looking for, because there's no way to trace where that came from, at least initially right now. And then we also have been looking at node importance. I won't spend too much time on this, otherwise to say that this is kind of called page rank, but it's really the importance of each node based on the number of incoming relationships. And there was, you know, GTEx, the experimental expression, the GTEx expression is very narrow here, meaning that they're not impinging on a lot of, they don't have a lot of connections, and they're not impinging on nodes that have a lot of connections, which makes sense, which you'll see in a slide in a minute. But that makes sense. But then the EQTLs have a lot of connections, and they connect to a lot of different things, which you'll also see. But that's because they're going through dbSNP, which is a variant, and probably also connecting. It's also connecting to other things, which I'll show you in a minute. So they have a much wider degree importance. But this is really preliminary, and how we use this and how we make decisions in this is going to evolve over time, and this graph will change as we start pruning and selecting out our data. So, for example, this is the kind of the connection graph, and it shows you how the relationships between the Common Fund data sets and the ontologies are operating right now. We don't have nodes per se for mammalian phenotype from COM2. We don't have concepts for those because we set that up as a relationship. But just in the concept nodes themselves, for GTEx, the EQTLs connect to both dbSNP because that's the ID, but they also connect out to HGNC. They'll have relationships to HGNC because there's a gene relationship to the EQTLs. And there'll be also some relationships to tissue, right, through Uberon. And then the experimental data, the expression data also simultaneously goes to Uberon and HGNC, but doesn't really go to dbSNP because there's no relationship between the expression and a particular SNP, except through the EQTL. So this makes perfect sense to what we have so far. And then the relationships between MP and HGNC, which you should see right through here, those relationships in HPO in the genes and MP in the genes, which I don't see that there, but you'll have to trust me that it's there. It might be behind this one, but those are relationships based on COMP2 data. So these are kind of like I'm not gonna spend too much time, so we have time for a couple of questions, but essentially we have a whole bunch of different ways of going between variant ID, gene ID, phenotype ID, tissue ID, and jumping between those. And these are the kind of queries that people can do as part of that. They can look at expression, they can look at EQTL association, you can select genes based on EQTL association and phenotypes. You can go back and forth among all these different knowledge graphs, and the queries can be quite large. So part of our job is going to be trying to make sure that the queries, when they're executed, return reasonable and constrained results and don't give you the whole map back. And that's what we're working on now. So our progress is we've been able to stand up this Neo4j copy from HubMap and Silverstone. We created a model for linking the COM2 to kids first data, basically through phenotypes. We've linked the human genes to corresponding orthologs. That's in the database now. We've been able to link mouse genes to mouse phenotypes for COM2 IMPC. We've added mammalian phenotype into the graph. We've linked the human phenotypes to the corresponding MP terms, which is an ongoing project, and with Nico and Tiffany. And we've also created a data model for the GTEx data that can live in the same data graph structure model as UMLS as created by Jonathan. We're going to be adding HubMap data, which is already modeled. We just have to start adding that in. Lynx data, Taha is working on that right now and preparing. There's already drug bank data. There's already compound data in UMLS, as you would expect, because it is a medical dictionary. So we're going to start being able to link HGNC genes to those compounds and create new compound IDs for the ones that aren't in UMLS. So that's something that Taha is working on now. And then we're going to be passing on queries, the start of the queries, to the Urbanowitz lab at the end of this month. So there's a GitHub for our project, which is still, it's still early, but that's the presentation. And I hope it's interesting and exciting to some people. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Deanne. So I encourage people to go to the Slido link that's in the chat and also on the screen to answer additional questions. So our first question is, the use of UMLS also brings a lot of noise into the data. How did you manage to reduce the noise while generating the knowledge graph?
So the knowledge graph, so it's restricted. So we didn't bring in the structure of UMLS, or the scheme of UMLS is not completely brought into the knowledge graph. It's a reduced set of very specific, you know, concepts. You saw some of the noise yourself. We just talked about it. But we brought in just the concepts, the code, and the term. And there's really not all of the, not everything was brought in. I can't go through it all right now, but it was kind of like a bare bones minimum UMLS schema. There are still problems with the noise, as you saw, like that 55,000 connections between the different nodes that we're going to either have to prune manually, like just remove those kinds of nodes, or hopefully just in the queries, be able to remove those in a query and exclude those from the transversal. So that's kind of how we went about it. Jonathan did the initial lift of putting the UMLS, his reduced form of UMLS, into that knowledge graph. So if you want more information exactly what he did, I can put you in contact with him.
Okay. How can beginners get, okay. Oh yeah, how can beginners get started and make best of these integrated data sets for our own research?
Well, you don't really need our knowledge graph to start that. I mean, you can go to GTEx and download the data. You can go into Comp2 or IMPC and download data like we did. The best thing to do is decide on what your scientific question is and get the right data for that. Common Fund people would be happy to help you with that. And I would too, if you want to email me and I can send you to the right people. If you have specific scientific questions, we could probably come up with some great recommendations. Harmonosome, if you search for Harmonosome, they also put together a searchable resource on different data sets that you can do your own analyses on. The difference between us and Harmonosome is Harmonosome is a huge resource with a lot of separate data sets, but they're integrated together at a query level. We're trying to put them together in the same environment, but they've done a much more comprehensive job than we have so far with integrating all these two different data types together. So you can either wait for when we finish, go to Harmonosome, or try to find very specific Common Fund data sets that answer your questions.
Okay, and then how do you handle UMLS updates?
That's a great question. So we already have plans for that. So UMLS updates we're going to test and ingest the new UMLS update. And then most of our unless the concept numbers change, which I hope they don't, most of our relationships should stay, because we're using the base UMLS and then adding things in. So we could, if we have to, we could start over from scratch adding things in. It's not difficult if you have the term or the code for the gene ID to go and put that homology back in. So we're actually adding all our stuff isn't added monolithically. We start with the UMLS database that Jonathan put together and could re-update with a new version. And we add in files and sections of different relationships. So we're adding in GTEx on its own. We're adding in GTEx ETLs on its own. We're adding in different information on the mammalian phenotype on its own. So it's kind of like modules that are added in. So we're pretty confident that we can handle that.
Hey, thank you so much, Deanne. So let me hand it back over to Laura to close.
Email me if anyone has any questions. I'll put my email in the chat if you don't already have it, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. Yep.
I think you're on mute, Laura.
Thank you. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, I just want to say thank you so much for your wonderful presentation, Dr. Taylor. That was really fascinating and a wonderful example of some of the infrastructure that we need to build for our ecosystem. And thank you very much to Chris for your recommendation and for hosting our speaker today. And I hope to see you all next month at the next speaker series. Thank you so much.
Thank you.